I can share with you the information on the card. Gives our ashram address and our home phone number. Then Baladeva Vidyabhusana's email and my email. Then our Facebook address. And then the website sdglegacy.com, which is run by Ishwara Govinda, who is here today. And there are a lot of good things on sdglegacy.com. All of my books are listed there in e-form. And he has many videos too. And then there's another website, sasvarupadasgoswami.com, which is different than legacy.com. I'm posting a journal called Free Write Journal every week on these websites. I'm up to the 18th week now. But I think many of my disciples don't read this. This isn't good. Haryaspa?
Yes?
Where are you going?
I get your cowgirl to see me.
Do you read the journal?
I don't read the journal, Guru Maharaj, but I read your books.
You should read the journal too.
Read the journal, Guru Maharaj.
There's also a Facebook page.
It's on the Facebook page. I put a lot of effort into doing that journal. And so you should read it. It's filled with intimate details of my activities and thoughts. And it's easy to read. Welcome to my Vyas Puja 2018. In Chaitanya Charitamrita, Krishnadas Kaviraj describes the tree of Lord Chaitanya. He mentions many big branches like Lord Nityananda, Advaita Charya, etc., etc. In a purport, Srila Prabhupada declares that ISKCON is a branch on the tree of Lord Chaitanya. Prabhupada is the founder acharya of ISKCON. He initiated some 5,000 disciples, and since his disappearance, many of his disciples have become initiating gurus. Jayapataka Maharaj, Gopal Krishna Maharaj, and Radhanath Maharaj have each initiated thousands of disciples. I am not initiating anymore, but I have initiated about 900 devotees, many of them living in the USA and in the Caribbean countries, and scattered throughout Europe. I also have Shiksha disciples, some of whom are rendering active service. I like to think of me and my disciples as a family. We bond together by your reading my many books and my weekly journal posted on my websites. We meet twice a year at family gatherings in Stuyvesant Falls, a Vyas Bhuj meeting in December, and a summer meeting. I am open to correspondence and personal meetings. I am open to giving guidance, counseling, and answering questions. After my talk, I'm going to open the floor to devotees speaking homages. This is a standard practice, but I hesitate to do it because I am embarrassed hearing my praises. I take solace in the talk Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gave on one of his Vyas Pujas. He addressed the phenomena of the Guru being praised and honored. The lecture was given on the 10th of July 1927 at the Gaudiya Math in Cuttack. The beginning of this lecture is very humorous and sarcastic. We don't think of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati as a humorous person. I don't think I've seen a picture of him smiling. He just looks so stern. But in this speech, he's hilarious with a satire on the Guru, who has taken a position above all others in the hall. He begins, "We have taken upon ourselves the responsibility of welcoming this grave charge. All in the audience have accepted ordinary seats. I alone have been provided with a lofty seat. All, in effect, are being told, have a look at a big animal from the zoo gardens. What arrogance, so foolish, so wicked. Have you ever seen such a big brute? Garlands of flowers have been put around his neck. What laudations, what bombastic, long-drawn, hyperbolic adjectives. And how complacently he is sitting, listening to the praise of his own achievements. How intently and with his own ears. Evidently, he also feels delighted. Is he not acting in plain violation of the teachings of Mahaprabhu? Can such a big brute, so selfish and impudent, ever be reclaimed from brutishness?" Then he changes his mood. "I happen to be one of the greatest of fools. Because of my arrogance, no one offers me good advice. Insomuch as nobody condescends to instruct me, it occurred to me that I should present my case to Mahaprabhu himself and see how he would advise me. Then Sri Chaitanya Dev said to me, 'Whomever you meet, instructing regarding Krishna, on my order, become a guru and save this land. In this, you will not be obstructed by the current of the world. You will have my company once again at this place.' In these verses is found the proper explanation of the apparent incons- consistency described above. This is a continuation of his lecture. He whose only teaching is humility more than that of a blade of grass said, by my command become a guru and save this land. In this instance, Mahaprabhu himself has given a decree, perform the duty of guru, even as I myself do. Convey this same instruction to whomever you chance to meet. Chaitanya Deva says, tell them these very words, on my order, become a guru and save this land. Deliver people from their foolishness. Now, whoever happens to hear these words would naturally protest with palms joined. But I am really a great sinner. How can I be guru? You are Godhead himself, the Jagat Guru. Only you can be guru. To this, Mahaprabhu states, in this, you will not be obstructed by the current of the world. You will have my company once again at this place. Do not practice the occupation of a guru for the purpose of injuring others through malice. Do not adopt the livelihood of a guru to become immersed in the slough of this world. But if indeed you can be my guileless servant, you'll be endowed with my power, that you need not fear. I have no fear. My Gurudev has heard this instruction from his Gurudev. And it is for this reason that my Gurudev accepted even such a great sinner as I and told me, on my order become a guru and save this land. Only those who have never heard these words of Sri Gaurisundar say, how bizarre to listen to one's own praise. In their opinion, while the guru is instructing the disciple in the 11th canto of the Bhagavatam, he is perpetuating a major sin. What is the acharya to do when he has to explain the verse, acharyamam vijani yat? Never disregard the acharya or consider him your equal in any sense. These are the words of Krishna himself, whereby the jiva is to be benefited. Is the guru to desert his seat, the seat of the acharya, from this which these words are to be explained? That office was conferred on him by his Gurudev. If he does not act up to its requirements, he is doomed to perdition for his offense against the holy name in the shape of disrespect toward his guru. He must execute his duty notwithstanding such behavior. Being open to the charge of egoism. When the guru imparts the mantra to his disciple, should he tell him not to worship the guru by that mantra? Should he instead say, give the guru a few strokes of the shoe or horsewhip? The guru is never to be decried. The guru is the devotee of all gods. While reading from the Bhagavatam to his disciple, should the guru abstain from communicating these words to him? Only to him who possesses guileless spiritual devotion to the Guru, similar to that offered to Krishna himself, are the holy mysteries manifest. Is the Guru not to tell these things to his disciples? Adau Guru Puja. The worship of the Guru has precedence over all others. The Guru is to be served just as Krishna is served. The Guru is to be worshipped in a particular way. Is the Guru to desert his seat without telling all these things to the disciple? As the saying goes, having begun the dance, it is no use to draw the veil. I am doing the duty of Guru. Yet if I preach that no one should shout Jai to me, that is, if I merely say in a roundabout way, sing Jai to me, there would be nothing short of duplicity. Our Gurudev has not taught us such insincerity, nor has Mahaprabhu taught such insincerity. I must serve Bhagavan in a straightforward manner. That's the end of the lecture, quoted. So Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur is humbly, dutifully accepting the role of the spiritual master. Despite the outward appearance that he is being egotistical, he must follow his guru's order and the order of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Tell everyone you meet about Krishna, become guru and save the people of this land. I take solace in this lecture, and I'm able to hear the homages without pride. Krishna consciousness is the path of humility. I must remain humble, but I must not abandon the seat of being a guru. Now, Prabhupada. On September 2nd, 1972, Srila Prabhupada gave a talk at New Vrindavan as part of his series Bhagavad Dharma Discourses on the occasion of his Yas Puja. Prabhupada began his talk to a large audience of devotees and visitors. Ladies and gentlemen, this ceremony, of course, those who are my students, they know what is this ceremony. Those who are visitors, for their information, I may inform you something about this ceremony. Otherwise, it may be misinterpreted, misunderstood. An outsider may see that, why is a person being worshipped like God? There may be some doubt. So this is the etiquette. This ceremony is called Vyasa Puja. Vyasa means the original author of Vedic literature. He is the incarnation of Narayana. He gave us all Vedic knowledge. He received that knowledge from Narada. Narada received the knowledge from Brahma. Brahma received the knowledge from Krishna. So in this way, by the septic succession, we get transcendental knowledge. Prabhupada goes on. So this Yas Puja means one day in a year on the birthday of the spiritual master, because he is representative of Vyasa, he is delivering the same knowledge which has come down by the succession without any change. He is offered the respect. This is called Vyasa Puja. And the spiritual master receives all honor, all contribution on behalf of the Supreme Personality of the Godhead, not for his own person. Now he makes a reference to India, which is kind of quaint that he's speaking in 1972 in New Vrindavan, West Virginia. Just like in our country, when there was British rule, there was a viceroy, a king's representative. So naturally, when the viceroy used to go to some meeting, many people used to present valuable jewels just to honor him. But the law was that not a single of the jewels or contribution could the viceroy touch. It was going to the royal treasury. The viceroy could accept on behalf of the king all contribution, but it goes to the king. Similarly, this day, Vyasa Puja Day, whatever honor, contribution, and feelings is being offered to the spiritual master, it is, again, as we have received this knowledge from upwards, similarly, this respect also goes from downward to the upward. This is the process. So as the spiritual master is teacher of the student, he has to teach the student how to send back his respect and contribution to God. This is called Vyasa Puja. So this is the position of the spiritual master. Don't misunderstand that this person is sitting very comfortably and taking all honors and contribution. It is needed just to teach them how to respect the representative of God. This is the sum and substance of Vyasa Puja. I have one more document to read. It is the Vyasa Puja homage read by Abhay Charan Das for the members of the Sri Gaudiya Math in February 1936, on the occasion of the birth anniversary of His Divine Grace, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada. His Divine Grace Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati was very fond of the poem by Abhay Charan, and was especially pleased by the lines, "Absolutely sentient, thou hast proved. In personal calamity, thou hast moved." Prabhupada told us that Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati used to show this poem in an essay wrote, that our Prabhupada wrote with it, to important guests who visited him. So this is an ideal Vyasa Puja homage. And I'm reading it. Sri Vyasa Puja offering. 1. Adore ye all the happy day, blessed than heaven, sweeter than May. When he appeared at Puri, the holy place, my Lord and Master, His Divine Grace. 2. O my Master, the Evangelic Angel, give us thy light, light up thy candle, struggle for existence, a human race. The only hope is divine grace. 5. Message of service thou hast brought, a healthful life has Chaitanya wrought. Anon to all is full of grace, that's your gift, your divine grace. Absolute is sentient thou hast proved, in personal calamity thou hast moved. This gives us a life anew and afresh. Worship thy feet, your divine grace. Had you not come, 7. Had you not come who had told the message of Krishna, forceful and bold, that's your right. You have the mace. Save me a fallen, your divine grace. 8. The line of service is drawn by you, is pleasing and healthy like morning dew. The oldest of all, but in no dress, miracle done, your divine grace. So this is the evidence from 2 very great gurus, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, gives a picture of how it may be seen as egotistical and bizarre of the guru to accept honors and sit on a high seat. But then he took this dilemma to Lord Chaitanya, who says, tell everyone you meet about Krishna, become guru and save the people of this world. If you do, I will always be with you. So the guru remains humbler than a blade of grass. Prabhupada explains it with the example of India under the British rule. There used to be a viceroy who represented the king, and he would come. People would offer him all kinds of valuable contributions. But the law was that the viceroy could accept it, but he couldn't keep a single gift for himself. Everything had to be turned over to the royal treasury, to the king. If I listen to the homages in this way, I will be freed from pride and will remain humbler than a blade of grass. Now I'm going to open the floor to homages.